Whoa, there we go. it is good to see you on this wonderfully chilly, freezing Sunday morning. We were talking here before worship, and you know, we're a little bit lighter than we have been here this morning, but I got to be honest, I feel like we actually have more people than I expected, because I don't know about you, but when I was taking Jake to work, some of those roads were still pretty nasty this morning. So thank you for braving the wind-drifted tundra to make it out here this morning. It's good to see you. And it's good to see the rest of you at home, even though we can't really, you know, see you. Just a few announcements here as we head into worship. You can see some of the things that are happening this week here. We have a blood drive next on Wednesday. Next Saturday is game night. And it's, the Build a Sandwich game night. So that should be interesting. And then, of course, the rest of the things that are happening throughout the month as well here listed. Lots of stuff continuing to go on, which is always really exciting. Just to give you all a heads up, Rebecca put it out there for you, I think in an email this week. My phone service has decided to go the way of the dodo, meaning it's extinct. So if you're trying to get hold of me on my cell, and if you have been over the past week and a half, and I haven't gotten back to you, that's why, because I haven't received anything. I'm trying to get that sorted out. Hopefully that'll get sorted out this week, but just as a word of warning, keep your eyes open. Very, very possible I might wind up having a new cell number. So if you need to get hold of me that way, keep your eyes open. If it changes from what you have already, I'll let you know. But I'm just going to be excited to be able to actually start making phone calls again. You guys realize that you don't realize how much you rely on that kind of stuff until all of a sudden it's not there. You know, it's very off-putting. That said, anything else for the good of the congregation as we go into worship? All right.
Good morning, everyone. Good to see all of you here this morning, as Brent said, on a chilly Sunday morning. But we have warm hearts and a place to be, so we are here to worship. So let's stand and let's sing this morning, a song we haven't done for a while, Lift High the Cross. Let's stand and sing.
Oh,
Father, we do lift high the cross as we move through this Lenten season and we reflect on the sacrifice and the love that you showed to us because of that sacrifice. May we lift your name, lift that cross, lift that message to the world that is hurting and looking for answers, looking for that salvation, looking for that healing that they so need. Be with us in this worship today. We pray this all in your name. Amen. We continue with Hallelujah. What a Savior. What a Savior we have.
First of all, I love that song, that hymn, but I wonder if any of you share in this affliction when line after line rhymes and then the one verse has stood, but then blood. And do you have to fight not to say it blood? It's a problem. The struggle is real, folks. All right. So, as we go to God in prayer this morning, we want to lift up Brenda, who has just been diagnosed with an aggressive cancer of the liver. And she has an appointment here on Wednesday to plan out some kind of a course for care and to hopefully overcome. I would also lift up a praise. Most of you have met my eldest, Jake, in all of his glory and wonderment. But he's been in physical therapy for the last 4 years. He's had tremendous pain in his hips and stuff like that when he was just walking. And he has progressed enough that he was discharged from physical therapy on Wednesday. So that's cool. That's my boy. Anything else to lift up before Almighty God today? Carla?
My dad, George Schaefer, was taken back in the hospital yesterday, and he needs his gallbladder removed, but with his heart condition, we don't know what's going to happen. And also, Todd Glass is back in the hospital for the third time due to the COVID and also due to his cancer issues.
Okay, so for George Schaefer, who is in the hospital, he needs to have his gallbladder removed, but has some other issues presenting that might get in the way of that happening simply. And for Todd Glass, who is also back in a hospital with COVID and cancer-related issues. Anyone else? All right, well, let's bow our heads together. Gracious God, we come before you this morning, and we are so thankful that we have a warm place that we can gather and come before your throne in worship and in praise. And we ask that you would be here with us and that you would bless us with a warmth of heart and a warmth of spirit as we seek you to prepare for the coming week. And we thank you that you are faithful. We thank you that you walk with us. We thank you that your grace rests on each of us each and every day and each and every moment. And we ask that you would open our hearts to receive that grace so that we can feel your presence and your guidance every step of every day. Lord, we lift up Brenda before you, and we ask that you would give her hope. We ask that you would give her strength. And Lord, as she goes in to speak with the doctors to figure out how to best approach this cancer, that you would guide their wisdom, that you would help them to put into practice all that they know to bring her through to health and wholeness. Lord, I thank you for Jake's discharge from physical therapy and all the progress that he's made. We thank you for those that you put in our lives to help us overcome the obstacles that we face, whatever they may be. And Lord, we ask that you would help us to see you at work in those people that you are using to help us along our journey. We pray for George, and we ask that you would give him comfort. We pray that you would give the doctors that are caring for him wisdom as they figure out how to handle his gallbladder situation, given the other complications, and we trust that you'll bring him through this on the other side healthy. We pray for Todd and ask that you would be with him and give him strength as he continues to fight against the issues caused by COVID and his cancer. Lord, give him wisdom to follow all that the doctors call him to do. And Lord, we pray that your power and your strength will rest on him. Lord, as each of us prepare for the coming week, we pray that you would give us eyes to see the needs that are all around us. We ask that you would give us compassionate hearts that when we see those who are hurting and broken, we would be compelled and inspired to reach out and speak life into their circumstance. And Lord, we pray that you would help us to conduct ourselves in such a way that wherever we go, people see the light of your sun shining through us. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen. Aiden's going to try something here today. We had a little bit of a snafu in terms of getting the actual papers with the scripture on it into this young man's hands. He's going to go for the big screen reading.
1 Samuel chapter 20. Then David fled from Naoth and Ramah and went to Jonathan and asked, "What have I done? What is my crime? How have I wronged your father that he is trying to kill me?" "Never," Jonathan replied. "You are not going to die. Look, my father doesn't do anything great or small without letting me know. Why would he hide this from me? It isn't so." But David took an oath and said, "Your father knows very well that I have found favor in your eyes, and he has said to himself, 'Jonathan must not know this, or he will be grieved.' Yes, as surely as the Lord lives, and as you live, there is only once a step between me and death." Jonathan said to David, "Whatever you want me to do, I will do for you." So David said, "Look, tomorrow is the new moon feast, and I am supposed to dine with the king, but let me go and hide in the field until the evening of the day after tomorrow. If your father misses me at all, tell him, 'David earnestly asked my permission to hurry to Bethlehem, his hometown, because an annual sacrifice is being made there for his whole clan.' If he says, 'Very well, then, your servant is safe.' But if he loses his temper, you can be sure that he is just determined to harm me. As for you, show kindness to your servant, for you have brought him into a covenant with you before the Lord. If I am guilty, then kill me yourself. Why hand me over to your father?" "Never," Jonathan said. "If I had the least inkling that my father was determined to harm you, why wouldn't I tell you? David asked, who will tell me if your father answers you harshly? Come, Jonathan said, let's go out into the field. So they went there together. Then Jonathan said to David, I swear by the Lord, the God of Israel, that I will surely sound out my father by this time the day after tomorrow. If he is favorably disposed toward you, I will not send you word but let you know. But if my father intends to harm you, may the Lord deal with Jonathan. Be it ever so severely, if I do not let you know and send you away in peace, may the Lord be with you as he has been with my father. But show me unfailing kindness like the Lord's kindness as long as I live, so that may not be killed, and do not ever cut off your kindness from my family. Not even when the Lord has cut off every one of David's enemies from the face of the earth. So Jonathan made a covenant with the house of David, saying, may the Lord call David's enemies to account. And Jonathan had David reaffirm his oath out of love for him, because he loved him as he loved himself. Then Jonathan said to David, tomorrow is a new moon feast. You will be missed because your seat will be empty. The day after tomorrow, toward evening, go to the place where you hid when this trouble began, and wait by the stone Ezel. I will shoot three arrows to the side of it as though I were shooting at a target. Then I will send a boy and say, go find the arrows. If I say to him, look, the arrows are on this side of you, bring them here, then come, because as surely as the Lord lives, you are safe, there is no danger. But if I say to the boy, look, the arrows are beyond you, then you must go, because the Lord sent you away. And about the matter you and I discussed, remember, the Lord is witness between you and me forever. So David in the field and went to the, and when the new moon feast came, the king sat down to eat. He sat in the customary place by the wall opposite Jonathan, and Abner sat next to Saul. But David's place was empty. Saul said nothing that day, for he thought something must have happened to David to make him ceremonially unclean. Surely he is unclean. But the next day, the second day of the month, David's place was empty again. Then Saul said to his son Jonathan, why hasn't the son of Jesse come to the meal, either yesterday or today? Jonathan answered, David earnestly asked me for permission to go to Bethlehem. He said, let me go, because our family is observing a sacrifice in the town, and my brother has ordered me to be there. If I have found favor in your eyes, let me get away to see my brothers. That is why he has not come to the king's table. Saul's anger flared up at Jonathan, and he said to him, you son of a persevere and rebellious woman, don't I know that you have sided with the son of Jesse to your own shame and to the shame of the mother who bore you? As long as the son of Jesse lives on this earth, neither you nor your kingdom will be established. Now send someone to bring him to me, for he must die. Why should he be put to death? What has he done? Jonathan asked his father, but Saul hurled his spear at him to kill him. Then Jonathan knew that his father intended to kill David. Jonathan got up from the table in fierce anger. On that second day of the feast, he did not eat because he grieved at his father's shameful treatment of David. In the morning, Jonathan went out to the field for his meeting with David. He had a small boy with him, and he said to the boy, run and find the arrows I shoot. As the boy ran, he shot an arrow beyond him. When the boy came to the place where Jonathan's arrow had fallen, Jonathan called out after him, isn't the arrow beyond you? Then he shouted, hurry, go quickly, don't stop. The boy picked up the arrow and returned to his master. The boy knew nothing about all this, only Jonathan and David knew. Then Jonathan gave his weapons to the boy and said, go carry them back to town. After the boy had gone, David got up from the south side of the stone and bowed down before Jonathan three times with his face to the ground. And they kissed. Then they kissed each other and wept together, but David wept the most. Jonathan wept the most. Jonathan said to David, "Go in peace, for we have sworn friendship with each other in the name of the Lord, saying, 'The Lord is witness between you and me, and between your descendants and my descendants forever.'" Then David left, and Jonathan went back to the town. Matthew chapter 9, verse 9 through 13. As Jesus went on from there, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax collector's booth. "Follow me," he told him, and Matthew got up and followed him. While Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" On hearing this, Jesus said, It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice, for I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners. This is the word of our Lord.
Rebecca got on me about this a little bit. She said, "You realize what you've done to this poor guy the last two times he's read scripture, right?" Because you had a humdinger the last time too, but you did a great job. What's going on here? Did it feel a little bit like story time this morning? Right? Which is great. I mean, I like the way some of these passages are put together in that kind of a way. There's something that you don't quite get unless you read the whole thing, you know. And I think that passage that Aiden read with David and Jonathan is one of those passages. And as he's reading it, and you know what's coming, there's two things that I thought, which is thank goodness Jonathan was a good shot with his bow. That could have turned out badly. And the other was a kind of a, really? Because it says that Jonathan hadn't figured out that his dad wanted to kill David until his dad tried to kill him by chucking a spear at him. And I thought, I don't know, I think you should be bright enough to have figured that out before you almost got killed and impaled by your father. But that story, we're going to see, fleshes out something really, really significant for us. We're in our Lenten series on spiritual disciplines. Last week, we looked at Holy Communion. This morning, we're going to look at fellowship. Christian fellowship is one of our spiritual disciplines. Now, fellowship doesn't usually occur to people as a spiritual discipline because it just doesn't have the same feel to it as the other ones we typically talk about. It's looser, sometimes it's even kind of chaotic, this idea of fellowship, because really all fellowship is when we spend time together and just sort of get to know each other. And there's not always a lot of structure around that. And when we think discipline, we think something that does have a very fixed structure or a very fine purpose to it. So for example, communion is definitely a very focused moment. It's very specific. When we do Bible study, that's specific. We're looking at certain scriptures or a certain book of the Bible or a certain theme in the Bible. Prayer, very specific, right? All of that stuff is intentional and lasered in on something, whereas fellowship isn't so much, right? Think about just as simple as right before or right after worship or Sunday school, when we have, you know, a relatively full sanctuary. What does it look like out in the gathering area? Does it look very focused and lasered and dialed in? Or is it just a bunch of people kind of in blobs? around the gathering area sipping coffee and talking about whatever they're talking about, right? You can literally have 10 different conversations going on about 10 completely different things all at the same time, right? Sometimes it's loud, sometimes it's a little bit raucous. You hear Sharon cackling over there in the corner somewhere. It's a good thing. It's laughter, right? John West is running around in his grass hula skirt, whatever's going on. It's lively, right? It's not like anything's trying to tether it in and make it something that it's not, but it's important. It's really important. And there is a discipline to it. It's just different than the other ones. The discipline that comes with Christian fellowship is intentionally carving out time for it. It's making sure we take the time to go and do things with other people of like faith. That takes intentionality, right? One of the things we've talked about on Sunday mornings every here and again is the fact that our culture right now is a much more tentative culture, that we live in a society that's very much a unless something better comes along. So that many commitments aren't really commitments. They are, yeah, I'll do that, but I'm always going to leave a little bit of room in case something else comes up that I might want to do more. It takes intentionality to make a commitment and stick to it, because we are living in a time when there's more and more and more and more and more things that are available to draw our attention different places or tempt us away from a commitment we've already made. So it takes discipline to hold to those commitments. How many of you realize that we say no far more than we say yes? You realize that? Because every time we say yes to a commitment, what else are we saying? We're saying no to everything else we could be doing during that time frame. When we make a commitment to come here on Sunday mornings and say, I'm going to be in church from 9:30 to 10:30 or from 9:30 until 11:30 if you do Sunday school, what we're saying is, if someone invites me out for breakfast at 10 o'clock in the morning, I'm saying no. If there's a movie that I would like to watch that's on TV at 9:30 in the morning, I'm going to say no. If somebody asks me to go to the gym with them at 11, I'm going to say no. So every time we say yes, we're saying no to a ton of other things because we've already cut them out. We've committed ourselves to that point in time. It takes intention. It takes intention to know what is even available, right? How many of you look at these wonderful things every Sunday? How many of you know that all the stuff and more that's in here gets communicated through email and snail mail and on our Facebook page and on our web page every week? How many of you also know that we still hear people say, I didn't know that was going on? Some of that was nervous laughter. But my point is that it takes intention for us to keep ourselves abreast of everything that's happening, because those are places where we can encounter that Christian fellowship if we understand what's happening with in our community of faith. But we can't know where those opportunities are if we're not looking for them. It takes intentionality to not just know what's happening, but also it takes a discipline to say, maybe there's something I haven't done before, but I'm going to give it a shot. Step out of my comfort zone a little bit. That's intentional. That's discipline. And then what happens amidst all of that, well, that's more organic. But it's necessary. It's absolutely necessary. Because it's in those moments of fellowship that we forge those bonds of community. Right? We do that in worship, we do that in other things, but the reality is that it's in those looser times when we just get to talk with each other and share some space with each other that the conversations take a life of their own and we start to learn about each other. We start to see who God has created us to be. We get to know one another's life experiences. We get to share ours. We get to hear others. And it's in those places, and this is where it gets critical, it's where we are able to speak Christ into one another's lives as those things start to come up, as we feel more comfortable with each other and we're allowing ourselves to be more vulnerable and we share what's happening, and then the people we're talking with, because they have a very similar faith compass and they want to be used of God just as we want to be used of God, then we speak into those circumstances. I'm going to suggest that this may be one of the spiritual disciplines that helps us see our faith hit the ground in some of the most practical possible ways. Because when we're in those more focused environments, they're great and they're necessary, but they may not lend themselves to certain topics of conversation coming up. But we get into those looser environments and the conversation just kind of flows on its own. And suddenly we know each other and we see each other differently. And then our faith guides us to interact with each other in a way that lifts everybody up. God betters us through our relationships. That's what fellowship does. And fellowship happens around all kinds of different things. What's one of the favorite things that the United Methodist fellowship around is food. Right? We have our Tuesday dinners, we have our stoners lunches, we have our 30 West breakfast, we have potlucks, we have our community breakfast in July. We have all these things that center around food, right? But what else happens with the food? Do we just sit there and keep our head down and put our plate out there and let somebody fill it and just kind of shuffle on down and then sit down and just go, wolf it down? You know, right there, Carolyn. Just wolf it on down. We don't say a word. Throw the plate in the garbage and off we go. Is that how that works? What else happens? Fellowship. We talk. We laugh. We have a good time. We are known and we get to know one another. And we see God at work in each other's lives. And then the conversation that unfolds. When I was working in the group home system, you'd have a caseload of kids, and you're responsible for doing their individual and their family counseling sessions. And we were encouraged to not always let the individual sessions only happen in an office. Because especially when you're dealing with a teenager, and by the way, adults are really no different in a lot of ways, that formal setting is stifling. Sometimes it's even intimidating. Some of the best times you ever had talking with a kid happen over a pool table or happen while you're shooting hoops. Because that activity, that common thing that you're doing, it kind of takes the pressure off. It's just enough of a distraction that we can let our guard down. Just enough of a distraction that we can loosen up and talk and share and fellowship freely in a way that we might not otherwise. And in that, we know and we become known by the other. It happens all the time. And it's not just like basketball and pool. I'm betting that when you guys do Stitch 1, Pray 2, that you're not just doing this the whole time. I'm probably not even doing this right, but right? You're getting to know and you're letting yourself be known. Conversation, a common activity, but it's fellowship as well. Like I said, in all of that, God is working constantly, constantly. Now, we have to understand that fellowship isn't only for Christians. If we only fellowship with other Christians, then how does the gospel ever get out to people who don't believe? It doesn't, right? So we got to have both. But the Christian fellowship as a spiritual discipline is so critical to us, because that is part of where we as people of faith get our guidance and get uplifted, and where we share, where we can know what to pray for each other for. Those are the things that help us engage other spiritual disciplines in a more meaningful way. They all link together. And we're going to see here in a minute why this idea is so important. So the first thing I want us to consider is when Jesus is sitting there with the tax collectors and the sinners. What's he doing with them? Eating, drinking, and fellowshipping. It's him, his disciples, and these other folks that the religious muckety-mucks and hoity-toities are saying, why on earth are they sitting there with these people? That's not okay. Jesus and the disciples, on the other hand, understand the value of fellowship in ministry. They understand the value of fellowship together. They are getting to know these folks and letting the other folks get to know them. And that is where the message starts to come out the most powerfully. When somebody gives a message, do we believe everybody equally? Are there people that tell you something and when you hear it, you immediately say, I don't know that I'm going to buy into that? And it may not be the message, it may be the messenger. It's credibility, it's authenticity, it's genuineness. And the only way those things happen is when we allow ourselves to get to know each other, where there's some measure of fellowship that's happening. And I want you to think about this, and we don't often talk about this because some people get uncomfortable with it, because Jesus is God, right? We're on the same page with that? He's divine? How many of you know that Jesus was not able to persuade everybody to believe his message? Now, he's God, and he's not cosmic whammying people in a way that every single person he comes across is like, oh, I never knew. Thank you for telling me. Not everybody believed him. Not everybody believed in him, and that still holds true today. But who are the people that changed the world after his ascension? It was the ones with whom he forged the deepest relationships, his disciples. It was the guys that he, and women too, that he that traveled with him, that ministered with him. Now, we see the highlights of the ministry and that sort of thing when we read the Gospels, right? And we read Scripture. But those things are only often snapshots in time. In fact, one of the things we note in Bible study over and over again is sometimes we assume that one chapter ends and another one begins, and it's like this chapter ends and the next day, that's when the other one begins. Sometimes there's weeks between chapters, maybe years between chapters. When you see that they were at this place, and then they traveled to this place, did they have bullet trains back then? No. So between here and there may have been days of travel. Well, what do you think they did while they traveled? They fellowshipped. That's what you do, right? I mean, when I go down to Mississippi with my instructor, and the last time I had his kind of almost adopted daughter and student, we were all going down in my little blue apple cart. It was a 2-day drive. And the drive up and back was just as much fun as the seminar we were going to over the weekend. Why? We were yucking it up. We were sharing stories. We were talking about how our lives have been going. We were fellowshipping on the way. We got closer. Relationships deepened. And when we understand this, when we see how Jesus' effectiveness in getting the church built really took off after he left, and the disciples who become apostles started to build that church up, and one of the big things was community. It was a fellowship of believers. It really was attractive to the world around them. And we see that the ones that were the most powerful are the ones that had the strongest relationships with Jesus. And we were reminded over and over again that God works incredibly powerfully through relationship. That's what fellowship forges. And when we look at the story of Jonathan and David, this is one of the great friendships of the Bible, right? Jonathan and David are like best buds for life kind of a thing. We also see something that is incredibly significant about the bonds of fellowship and family and community. Saul clearly has a mad on for David. He wants him dead. Jonathan is Saul's son. Jonathan has to make a decision. Who's he going to side with? Is he going to side with Dad, or is he going to side with David? Now, I'm assuming that we have all figured out from the passage that Aiden read that it's not a good idea to tick off the king, especially a king with anger management problems, right? Saul is not known to have a cool temper. He's not known to be the best king in the world either, especially before God, and that's the whole thing going on between him and David. But David knows that Saul's out to get him. And Jonathan isn't believing it, but Jonathan and David, they're tight. And like I said, Jonathan has a choice to make. Am I going to risk upsetting my dad and help my friend? Or am I going to bail on my friend out of fear of my father? And he takes the harder road. He takes the road of fellowship with David. And he does it because he knows what is and is not correct. He knows that David hasn't done anything to deserve the treatment that he's getting from Saul. He knows that his dad ain't right in the head. So he's going to make the decision that is correct. He is going to help David out, even at the potential cost of his own life. And we see that story unfold, and, you know, Saul reveals himself for who he is, this temperamental, angry guy who's just out to kill David. Jonathan reveals himself to be a true friend to David. David shows himself to be an incredibly grateful and true friend to Jonathan here at the end when Jonathan sort of follows through on his word and saves his bacon. Do you think Jonathan would have put himself at that kind of risk for somebody he didn't know? That he would put himself out there for just the average person that, you know, maybe he didn't have any connection to? I'm going to suggest he probably wouldn't have. What made the difference for Jonathan was the bonds of fellowship between he and David. That's what made the difference. And through those bonds, God worked in Jonathan to protect David, who would become that king of Israel, the man after God's own heart. God works through those bonds. Now, there's one thing, though, I do want to remind us of that we got to be careful, because this could potentially be used, that story, to illustrate this idea that floats around every now and again, that a real friend is somebody that has your back no matter what. Even if you're going to do something incredibly wrong and incredibly stupid, they'll be there arm in arm with you because they're your friend. And if they don't do that, they're not your friend. Anybody agree with that? Now, I agree with the statement that a true friend always has your back. But the question is, what does it mean to have our back? A good friend is both protective and corrective. A good friend, when we're in trouble and need help, and legitimately need help because it's correct, they will be there with us and for us. A legitimate friend, if I'm about to do something incredibly stupid, is also going to pull me up and say, Brent, you probably shouldn't do that because that's incredibly stupid. Having one another's back is about wanting the best for each other, right? And sometimes that means standing with, and sometimes that means standing in contention against. And that's okay, because that's how God works. How many of you have ever had somebody that, like, when you were in dire straits, had your back 100%? I mean, you couldn't have got through it without them. You ever have a friend along those lines, right? That's God working through your friend for support and uplifting. But have you ever also had somebody who was a deep and dear friend look at you and tell you you were way out of line? Is that a good thing? Yeah, absolutely. That's how God works. God uses us to be protective and corrective. But the only way those things happen is when we allow ourselves to know and be known with each other, when we fellowship together in a way that forms those bonds of family, of community, of friendship, particularly as it happens within the context of a Christian community. It's not easy to tell someone they're out of line. And often we have trouble hearing that unless it's somebody that we trust, unless it's someone we can be vulnerable around, who knows us. And it's often very hard for us to do the same thing if we're worried about how that's going to be received because we don't know how thick of a skin the person has. Well, if we forge those bonds of fellowship, suddenly that becomes a lot easier. Because even the discomfort, the difficult, the awkward, we know we're going to make it through the other side of that stronger than we were before, because that's what friendship, that's what Christian community is about. And so the spiritual discipline of fellowship is absolutely essential to our walk as people of faith. All through Scripture we see community. Community, community, community. If you're doing the Acts study with us, you see it all over the place. And that fellowship, it strengthens, it unburdens, it shares burdens. And when we are in those positions where we need understanding or correction or assistance, whatever it may be, typically, it's going to come from those places where we have taken the time to love one another through the bonds of fellowship, and God strikes our hearts and compels us to step up on behalf of another. How many of you enjoy the 15 minutes before worship starts? Or are you just miserable to be around each other? How many of you enjoy whenever we have a dinner and just sitting down around the table and smiling and laughing with the people that you're with? I'm going to throw another one out just because Darren and Steve are here. Like, we play volleyball on Thursday nights. And is that good fellowship? Even when people get whacked in the head by the volleyball? I will warn you, it's a dangerous sport. But you get to know each other, right? You get to have fun together. There's conversations before, there's conversations after. Everything that we do that has that component to it is valuable, it's necessary. And I just want to encourage you to remember, when those opportunities come, give yourself permission to be intentional, to commit to them. Because when we embrace those bonds of fellowship, it's not just that we get closer to each other, but we get closer to God. And through one another, God uplifts us, directs us, guides us, and watches over us. Remember, we're all part of a what? A royal priesthood. That means we're all in this together, and God is working through us all. Amen? All right, let's stand and join together in the first verse of God Be With You Till We Meet Again. Now let's go with the strength of a creating God, the redemption of Jesus Christ, and the guidance of the Holy Spirit to serve in all that we say and do. Amen.